Okay. Good afternoon. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, yes, Nisha, audible.
Tanish sir.
Yes, you're audible.
Thank you. Okay. So, good afternoon, everyone. This is Diksha Tiwari on behalf of Oriental Institute of Student Technology. Welcome to the 2-day short-term training program on the topic Docker under TEQIP3 by RGPD from 1 to speaker instructor for this STDP is Mr. Ashutosh Bakare. Today is the second day of the session. Yesterday we learned the basics of containers and Docker. Containers versus virtual machines, Docker architecture, and in the later part we saw hands-on and how to play with Docker. Start and run a container and exit a container. Now, I will request Mr. Ashutosh Bakare, sir, to proceed the session. Thank you.
Thank you so much, guys. Let me start the session. Just a minute.
Hello, Ashutosh sir.
Yes. Just a minute. I'm just starting the session. I hope my screen is visible to you.
Yes, sir. Your screen is visible.
And I guess I'm audible as well, loud and clear, right?
Yes, sir. Loud and
clear. Thank you. Thank you so much. Okay. Let's start the session. Let's have a quick look what we have discussed yesterday. Okay. We are here to discuss containers and Docker. You can mostly say that how to use containers using Docker. That is what our session is. Okay. Now, yesterday we have seen this presentation that what is Docker? This is the what we can say official definition of Docker is an open source project that automates the deployment of applications inside software containers. Okay, by providing an additional layer of abstraction and automation of operating system level virtualization on Linux and others. Okay, so but before that, we have discussed one thing, that is what is the need of container. Okay, so here with this slide, we have seen that why we need container and how Docker will help us to run the containers. Is there Docker only in the market? No, there are other tools as well. Then we have seen this most important part of discussion, that is what is the difference between containerization and virtual machines. Okay, this slide is mostly talking about Dockers. Okay, so that's why the name of that blue engine, it's written as Docker engine. You can replace that engine by any other container management software or container management platform. Okay. Then later on, we have seen that how it is helpful for developers. Then we have seen how it is good for DevOps. Okay. Then we have seen that how it works. When it says like how it works, we have discussed this diagram. Okay. And I guess half of the part we have already tried yesterday in the demonstration. Okay. That how you can pull the container. How you can pull the image from the registry. And then how we can run the containers. These things we have tried. Okay, so let's see next part. Before that, we have discussed this diagram that is called it as a Docker architecture. Okay, the platform which we are using for practice is sponsored by Docker community only. So what we go with is you have to create a login on hub.docker.com. This platform is actually registry service, which is sponsored by or maintained by, managed by or owned by Docker community only. Okay. And the platform which we have to use for practice is Play with Docker. Okay. So when you go with Play with Docker, it demands for the user ID for login. So that user ID is actually the Docker ID, means Docker Hub login. So you have to log in to hub.docker.com, create your login, whatever is your username and password. With the help of that, you have to log in here with play with Docker. Okay, so yesterday I was using my colleague's login account. Today I will go with the same account. So now yesterday I have login, so that's why today it is not asking for username and password. So I will directly click on start. This will give you a small platform where you need not to install anything. Okay, you just need to click on this add new instance and you can try working on this. Okay, then in regular practice, let's say you want to run all those things on your laptop or desktop. In that case, let's imagine that you're running Ubuntu 18 on your laptop or on your desktop machine. So what you can do is simple install Docker C on CentOS or Ubuntu, whichever OS you use, and follow the steps given by docs.docker.com. Don't follow any other link. Okay, there might be some variations, so it's better to go with the official Docker documents. So you can see here Docker docs. Okay, this will allow you to install Docker on your host. Installation methods are there. Using repository, you can install. First go with update, then have a repository. Okay, once you have a repository, go with a key. Once you have key, the final thing you have to do is apt update and then install Docker CE. Docker CE means community edition. See here, this was the command. So with the help of this, if you follow those steps, you will be able to run those things on your virtual machine or maybe your physical machine using terminal. Okay. If you want, I can give you the link as well in the chat box. If you use CentOS, then instead of Ubuntu, search for the CentOS help. Okay, thank you Tanish for those steps which you have mentioned in the chat box. Now what I'll go with is, I don't want to invest all those things. I'm having browser, I'm having internet access, so I'm not installing anything. I'm just using this play with Docker platform to practice Docker. Okay, so this is the node which is available for almost 4 hours with us. Okay, so what I'll do is I'll click here and press Alt Enter. Okay, so it become full screen. So Tanishq or Diksha, can you please reply in the chat box? Is the text visible to you? Can you read this? Or do you want me to increase the font size? Okay, cool. Still, I will increase by one. That is good. So now, let's do yesterday's stuff first. Okay. To run any particular container, to have any particular container, you need one image. Okay. So how you can get the image? From the registry. Okay. So if I do read this file slash etc. Docker and Docker daemon, okay, .json file. If I read this file is responsible to connect with the registries. Okay, if you are connecting with docker.io or any local registry, all those registries are mentioned here. Okay, next time if you are having your physical machine, so you can, and you in your college campus, you want your own registry to be get created. So you can create your registry and you can mention the name in this file. Okay, then we are going with the default registry. So let's say I want to create a CentOS image. CentOS container. Okay, to start some development, or maybe I want to write something, I want to perform something, or I just need to practice what is CentOS and how it works. So instead of having virtual machine, I can run a container using Docker. Okay, so what I need to do is first Docker images. See that locally I'm not having any image. So officially you can say that you cannot run any container on this machine right now. So we need image. So let's do one thing, Docker search. What I need? CentOS. Okay, to enter. So can you see that these many things are there, which are CentOS images, CentOS container images. You can see here second last column, it says official. Only one image is official, that is by the CentOS community. That's why it's an official one. Okay. So CentOS community or CentOS provider, they are giving you a image. So that is the trusted image actually. Then if you look any random image here, see this image. Okay. This image name is CentOS/MySQL-57-CentOS7. That is the name. It means the name itself indicates that it's a CentOS 7 having MySQL version 5.7 install on it. Okay, then here, see this. This description says that Oracle Java 8 Docker image based on CentOS 7. So if somebody wants Oracle Java in version 8 installed on a container with CentOS, so you can, instead of pulling this particular plain image, you can pull this particular image. Okay. So, but you have to be very sure. If you, as a student, that's fine, but if as an industry person, you have to be sure that this image is not official. It means it may have something which is not good for your organization. Okay, but as a student, as a beginner, it is perfectly fine to use any of the image. Okay, now let's say I'll go with this official image only. The name is CentOS. I'll copy the name and then I'll go with Docker pull image name. See, it has started pulling the image. Pulling means downloading the image. You can read the message, downloaded newer image for CentOS latest. See, we mentioned CentOS, but it has pulled the image CentOS latest. That latest is actually a tag. Latest is a tag. I haven't mentioned any tag or specific version. That's why by default latest version has arrived. Okay. Now if I check the previous command, Docker search, Docker images, you can see that previously this table was empty. Now it is showing I do have one image with me. Okay. CentOS image size is 215 MBs. 215 MBs, still very smaller than as compared to your mobile phone operating system as well. Great. So to create a container from this image, what we need, either the image name or the image ID, and I need to run a command, docker run -i -t. Okay, you can also write like this, -it, the image. If I want to give some name to the container, then name equals to, let's say my container name is my PC. Okay. From which image I want to make this? CentOS latest or CentOS, that is enough. And which command I want to run? I want to take an interactive shell access, bash access. So I will go with bash means terminal access. Can you feel the terminal change? It is saying root@some ID. Means right now I'm inside a container with the container ID 2A70 something. Okay. So if I read which operating system we are using here is /etc/os release name file. You can read on any Linux machine, any Linux or Unix machines, they definitely have this file saying that which operating system you are using. It is saying that it is CentOS Linux version 8. Okay, previously we have taken example of Ubuntu, right? You can start working on this particular container, and whenever you're done with your work, you can do exit. Okay, exit is a command. When you do exit, that contain this container will stop working. Let me show you. Okay, I'll use touch command, or let's say mkdir command, mkdir to create directory. Let's say practice name directory I want to create. Directory means folder. Okay, if you do ls, you can see here practice name directory is there. Okay, I want to create some files in that particular directory. So I'll do /practice/test:1.5. It means create 5 files: test1, test2, test3, test4, test5. Okay, you can check by ls command on a practice directory. See here, I do have a practice name folder, and inside that few files are there. Imagine that these files are very important for me in some important data, or maybe code is written here. Okay, I'll do exit. Once you do exit, you are out of that container now. If I check Docker PS, you can see that no container is running. That container got exited. How to verify this? You can read all the containers. Docker PS hyphen A. See here. This was the container ID 2A7022A6A something. Okay, that is unique. Then from which image we have created this particular container? From CentOS image. Okay, the command which we ran inside it is bash. It got created 2 minutes ago and got exited 15 seconds ago, and name is mypc. Okay, check the status. It is exited. Means just like you power off your laptop, right? It's the same way. The status is exited. Now what if I need to start this and use it again? Before that, let's see this. If I run the same command again, let's see what will happen. I'll just change the name, or I will remove the name section. I'll run this again. Here I'm in another container. Container ID is different. Yesterday only we have discussed this. If I run a Docker run command 10 times, it will create 10 different containers. So likewise, now it has created a separate container. So obviously the folder, practice folder, and those test one, test two, those files, those must not be here, right? Let's see. If I do ls, you can see that there is no practice name directory inside this. Means that is the proof that your previous container was different. This is a new container. Okay. If I do exit, you can see that this particular container got exited. If I check Docker PS, you can see that it is still not showing anything. Why? Because there is no current running container. But if I check by hyphen A, means all the containers, you can see here previously there was only one container running. Now it is showing two containers running. This was the previous one. This is the new one. You can read it. Container ID is 39 and 38 something. Then image name is CentOS only, because from the same image we have created this. Then command, again we run the same command bash. So it has created a container 58 seconds ago, and before 15 seconds we have exited it. Okay, this time we haven't mentioned any name to the container, so that's why it has taken this particular random name. Okay, so now the point is it like this, like whenever I create a container, so it will always occupy the terminal? Because let's say, see here, I have started running a container, so it has occupied the terminal. I'm not on the host machine anymore. I'm inside the container. When I do exit, it will be like the container will get exited. Is there any way to run the container in the background? it should not occupy my terminal. It should run separately in the background only. Whenever I need, I will put some command. So that container should give me the access. When I do exit, so it should remove the access, but container should remain running. Okay. So how to do that? It is very simple. Two things. I'll create a new container which will run in the background, or I will start any exited container that will by default go to exited state. Sorry, background state. Okay. So first I will do this thing. Let's create a new container, but I will apply a new character here, that is hyphen D option. Hyphen D stands for detach. I'm repeating it. Hyphen D stands for detach. Do not attach to the current bash process, current terminal process. Just got detached from that. So that's why hyphen D. I'll do enter. Can you see here? I'm on the same terminal, but it is showing some container ID. Actual container ID is this much long. Okay. But you can use starting 4-5 characters. That is also good. Okay. Now let's say if I check Docker PS, you can see here one container is running. Is that the same container? 407C0 something ID is there. This ID is also starting with the same thing. And it says that created 21 seconds ago. So obviously this is the latest container. Okay. Now this is running in the background. I'm on the same host machine terminal. So if I'm a developer and I want to take access of this particular container and want to do something. So how to run some commands inside the container? So very simple, copy this container ID or copy the name of the container. Okay. Anyone can do either the container ID or either the name. Okay. So here what I'll do is Docker exec execute hyphen I hyphen T means hyphen I hyphen I means interactive, T stands for terminal, means TTY. Okay. Or you can also write like this hyphen IT container ID. Okay. Then what command you want to run inside that container? Let's say if I run only ls command, it will go inside the container. It will perform the ls command. Whatever the output is there, it will display on this particular terminal and it will exit from that particular container. See this. Because if I run ls command here on the host machine, the output is something else. But if I do this on container, so it means it is running on this particular container, giving back me output and get exited. But the access got exited, not the container. Because if I still check Docker PS, my container is still running. You can see the status, it is up. What if I want to run more than one command? So what I'll do is exec, and here I will take the bash access. Bash means terminal process. So you can see here, I'm right now inside the container. If I do ls, you can see I'm right now inside the container. If I read which OS is this one. I want to install something. I want to write something. I want to test something. I can use this platform for any application creation, any development, anything. Okay. If I do exit, now I am back on the host machine. But this time when I'm exiting it, the process is still running. The reason behind this is you can see here, the container is still in up status. The reason behind this is you started this container in a background mode. You can see here, you have applied hyphen D option. Because of that, this container started in the detach mode, means running in the background. So that's why if you take exec bash access, so it is giving you a separate shell access or separate terminal access of the container. So that's why you can perform tasks on that terminal, and whenever you exit, that process will stop inside the container. Okay, but container will keep running. Now, intentionally, let's say I want to stop this particular container. So you just need to do one thing, do Docker PS, copy the container ID. Okay. And then do Docker stop and container ID or container name. So it is going to stop the containers working. Okay. So if I check by Docker PS command, you can see here my table is empty. Whereas if I check all the commands, sorry, all the containers running. So that's why Docker PS hyphen A. You could see that, or you can see this. This particular container is in the exited state since from last 15 seconds. Likewise, you can work with the containers. Now, if you want to start any one of those containers, those are exited. So what I'll do is I will open the first container of mine. For that container, we have mentioned the name as well, my PC. So you can work with container ID or container name. Both you can perform. Okay. So what I'll do is start and the container ID or container name. You can see here this container got started. How to verify? With a Docker PS command. See, same name, my PC, container ID is same. This container got created 11 minutes ago, but it is up from last 6 seconds. Getting this? Now I can perform operations into this image. Sorry, in this container, because it is in start or running phase. So what I'll do is Docker exec hyphen it my PC bash. I hope you people remember few minutes back when we started running the first container. At that time, we have created that practice name directory and some data was there, right? So you can see here, this was the same container. If I do ls, you can see here practice name directory is there, as well as you can check what is there in practice directory. All your programming files or whatever data you are having. So everything is as it is. Okay. If I do exit, it will exit the terminal, but not the container, because your container is still running in the background. Okay. And if you want to stop the container intentionally, whatever is your container ID or container name, for that you have to run a command Docker stop. Container ID or container name. I'll put container name. See, the container is no more running. It is in the exited state. Okay. Now, if that container is in exited state, so if we try to take access of it, it will show error. It is saying that container, this particular container ID is not running. So that's why you cannot perform anything on it. Okay. So look towards the history. What we have performed till now, we search CentOS. We pull the image. Search is for searching the image. Appropriate image matching with your pattern. My pattern is CentOS. Then select one image from that search results and apply Docker pull command to it. So Docker pull will download the image. Okay. Then Docker run, you can check with the Docker images that how many images and details of those images will shown from your machine only. Okay. Or from your host. Then if you run Docker run command, it will help you to create new container. And in new container, you want to take interactive and terminal access. So hyphen I hyphen T or hyphen IT. Then if you want to give some specific name to the container, put hyphen hyphen name equals to what name you want. Then which image you are using and what command you want to run inside it. Then if you run this command again without any name or by changing the name, you will be able to create a new container again. So here we have tried to create 3 different containers and we exited the terminal. We came out. Okay. The container got stopped. but to avoid that, I want like my container should keep running in the background, okay, unless and until I am going to stop it. So for that, you have to put hyphen D option along with hyphen I and hyphen T. You can also write one single statement like docker run hyphen itd, then run this. This will by default run your container in background, so you will be on the same host terminal. So you can check docker ps, you will see that container is running. Then with docker exec you can perform few operations or you can take access of your container. Okay, here I perform only ls command, here I try to perform the bash command, so I will get the interactive terminal. Then if you do exit from that, you can come out of it and docker stop container id or docker stop container name will stop the running containers working and make it exit. Okay, if any exited container is there, you can start its working by using docker stop. But whenever you start any container which is in exited state, okay, by using docker start command, your container will by default go in the detach mode, means in the background. Okay, and if container is in stop phase, you cannot take access of it using exec or any other method. Is that good? Any questions, any query are there, you can put it in the chat box. I'm here. Okay, I can see written by Tanishq. What is that? Please refrain from posting any other messages other than your queries or answers to the questions asked by sir. Can we work simultaneously on two containers, like one container for front end and one container in the database? So answer to your question is, Tanishq, we can run n number of containers at the same time. Okay, you can work with n number of containers at the same time. What you need is all the containers should run in the background, and you should have to take the exec access of each term, each container. You can work with them. Okay, fine. Any other question? Anyone is having any question? Okay, I can see one more question. What is the benefit of using Docker over a hypervisor? Rohit, I guess yesterday we have spent decent time to discuss this thing. Okay, but still I'll give you a quick answer. Hypervisor will give you virtualization capability. So like keeping resources limited to the virtual machines, okay, and let them access those resources in the desired frame only. Then it actually manages the reservation on the hardware. That is what the beauty of hypervisor. But at the same time, running the hypervisor and keeping reservation on the resources is sometime less useful for us. Why? Because I want to run a simple application, and for that I'm reserving 2 GB or 3 GB of RAM to run a virtual machine, 2 or 3 virtual CPUs to run one virtual machine. So that is actually wastage or less utilization of the hardware. Instead of that, if you use containers, not only Docker, any other tool as well you can use to run the containers. If you use containers, it will help you to run container kind of virtual environment with very less memory requirement as well as CPU requirement and everything. Okay. How can we connect two containers? Jagriti, good questions. If time permits, I will. Okay. Not sure completely, Jagriti, time will permit us to reach up to that moment or not, because many things we have to discuss yet within next 1 hour. After that, if time permits, I'll give you the answer of this. But remember, every container is having its own IP address, and all the IP addresses are in the same range. So obviously all the containers running on your machine are in the same network, but by default they cannot communicate with each other. Okay, so there is a --- link option available. With the help of that, you can connect containers to each other. Okay, and one more solution is there, where Docker will also help you to create a virtual network, Docker network. If you create a virtual Docker network and attach both the containers in the same network, in that case, two containers can communicate with each other. Is that okay, Jagriti? Fine. So two ways, --- link option, or creating a separate network and running the containers on that dedicated network will help you to communicate between containers. Okay, so where is the yesterday's notepad file? Maybe I have noted it down somewhere. Just a minute, okay. So yesterday's commands are here. Just below that, I'll go with day two. Below that, I'll paste the history which we have performed right now. So as a beginner, you can try this as it is. Later on, you can use any other image as well, like Ubuntu and all. I can see here Amman Pina's question. Network virtualization uses NAT or something else to in containers. Actually, we use by default bridge. Okay, there is a capacity or there is an alternative. You can go with NATing, but by default it runs with bridging. Okay, if you want, I can show you here with your terminal where you are running the means on the host machine. When you install Docker and start Docker, you will see that if I go with ifconfig or ipconfig command, you can see here a Docker zero name bridge is available. Can you see here Docker zero name bridge? This bridge will help, or this bridge will take care of having means providing IP addresses to the containers. And all the IP addresses to your containers will be in this particular range. of Docker Zero Bridge? Is that okay? How can we share data from one container to other container? Triveni, for that we do have a, you can attach volume from the host machine to the container, and the same volume later on you can join to any other container as well. Okay, and anyhow your containers are in the same network, so obviously you can, if you are, you want possible, Tripeni Shivare. Triveni, let me go with the thing what we have decided to go with. Okay, if time permits, I will give you that answer because we have limited time, right? Docker containers and all is a huge topic. It's not possible to perform everything practically right now within the time. So if time permits, definitely I'll show you that one. But seems difficult. Maybe we can arrange any other session. In that we can see that, okay, but let's discuss the basic things first, because as a beginner I guess that is most important, right? I hope you understand, Triveni. The notepad link is with you, yesterday's notepad file only. All those things what we have discussed right now, you people can try. Okay, the next example, let's say what, how to use multiple containers with different features and functionalities. Okay, so that one more thing, that networks component I have discussed, that it is through the Docker Zero Bridge. So is that concept clear to that? Amman. Okay, one more question I can see here by Sam, that is containers are best for Android programs. Sam, containers any type of development, not only application development, database designing, graphics designing and all. Mostly graphic designing containers are nowadays getting utilized because graphic designing softwares are very heavy. So that's why very less, means nowadays we are having those on containers available. Previously it was not there. Okay, hopefully very soon we'll get that as well. But any other kind of development, you can surely go with containers. Okay, you can run your Android Studio inside a container and then you can use it. Now let's see guys, I do have some containers running here, right? Docker PS command will show me that nothing is running, but if I put hyphen A, it is able to show me this thing that three containers are running, but all three are in exited state. Okay, now let's move to the next part. Every time we are getting this, that Docker run will help you to create a new container, right? Okay, so now let's move to the next part. Let's see, what if I want to use any network service? I want to use any network service on the containers. Okay, so what I'll do is, let's imagine any basic application is there, any application which runs on browser. Okay, web-based application, you can say it is already in the container and I want to use that for future development, or I'm just want to use it for testing or what. So what you can do is, three conditions are there. First is you can be user of that particular application. Second, you can be the tester of that application. third thing, maybe you want to take it as a basic, and on top of that you have to start your future development. Okay, so what I can do is I'll go with Docker search Mario. You heard about Mario game, right? Among them, I'll choose this third option. I'll just copy the name, and what I can do is Docker run -i tnd, I for interactive, T for terminal, D for detach. Okay. -name equals to game one from this particular image. But the problem with this thing is that game is actually in the browser. Means it will give you the, it will run the application on some port number. Okay, that port number is 80. Okay, so what I'll do is I will map container's port number 80 to the host machine's port number to access it. I'll show you the reason graphically as well, okay, by some drawing. Okay, but before that, have a look here. If I do -p 4545:80. My bad. What it sees? Unauthorized authorization required. Okay, wait for 2 minutes. Docker run -itd -name. Okay, I missed the command actually. So it is pulling the image. Now you can see, I'll tell you one more thing. Few minutes back only we have discussed this. We have to search the image. Once you find out the image, you have to pull the image. Once you pull the image, later on you can do the Docker run. But if you exactly know the name, then no need to go for Docker pull command. You can directly go with Docker run command. That will first download the image, means pull the image, and then run it. Okay, so if I check by Docker PS, you can see here. If you see here with the Docker run, it started running a new container. Okay, but I choose the wrong port because I checked the Docker PS. It is showing that port number 8080 is open, and by mistake I have taken port number 80. So it must be a Tomcat port, but I have used HTTPD port. Let me correct it. I'll do Docker stop game one, and I don't want this game one container to be exist on my machine anymore. So what I'll do is, after stopping this, I will permanently remove it. Okay. So now if I check by Docker PS, it is not running, but in Docker PS -a, it is showing that your container game one is available in exited state. Okay, if I go with Docker RM Docker RM and the container name or container ID, that container will get removed completely from your machine. See here, and now there is no way back to get that container back. Okay, so it's a risky command, but you can use it whenever you have any container which is of no use run for you. Okay, so what I'll do is I'll run the same command again, but this time I will choose the correct port as port number 8080. Okay, if I check by Docker PS command, my container is running. Okay, if I click on this one, you can see here it's a Mario game. How much time it take? 1 minute only to have this thing. You can see here I'm trying to play this game. This game is activated outside the container image. Okay, I just pull the image and I run it. When I run it, I am able to access the network service of it. Okay, you can see this. Even you people can play this. So imagine that if this game application is running, means your normal website, web servers, those kind of simple college level project you people do, or any industry grade project also you want to do, you can definitely run it on the containers. Getting it? Now the point is how actually I'm able to access, this particular image I'm converting into a container using this Docker run command. So how I'm able to access the port number of the container outside the network? Okay, that is the most important thing. So with a simple example of HTTPD or Apache web server, I will let you know this. Okay, so I'll draw this. See here, let's say I'm running a host machine. Host machine means a laptop or desktop or a cloud machine where Docker is installed. Okay. So let me type something here. That will be the name of the machine. Let's say it is a Docker host, which is running some containers on it. So let's imagine that I want to host a website, a web server. Okay. If I host a web server, so what I'll do is I want a container to be get hosted on my machine. Okay. Let's imagine this is my container. This container is obviously hosted on this particular machine. Okay. Now the scene is my container is having one separate IP address. As yesterday's discussion, isolated, they run in an isolated environment. They also use network resources. So every container will have its own IP address. And it is already having its own minimum required operating system and binaries. So if someone is installing Apache server inside this particular container, okay, on which port number Apache runs by default? Reply in the chat box. By default, port number 80, not 8080. 8080 is for Tomcat or Jenkins. Okay, but Apache runs on 80. That will be a TCP as well. Okay. Now the point is, I am saying that my container will host some website into it. So let's see. I'll consider that Apache will give you this kind of image, or you will take a random image of Ubuntu or CentOS and you will install Apache on it. Okay, you'll expose the port number 80 as well. Fine. But my genuine concern is very simple. This particular container is running on this particular host machine. So obviously both are in the same network. We have seen few minutes back here, right? That was Docker PS command. Sorry, not Docker PS. Ifconfig command. So where we have seen that Docker zero name bridge is there. Okay, with the help of this, you can say that your containers are in the same network of your host machine. So obviously, whatever website you host in container will be available or accessible on this host. Any doubt in this? Aapke jo website ya koi bhi service कंटेनर में चल रही है तो वो होस्ट मशीन पे बाय डिफॉल्ट एक्सेस होगी, ओके, इसमें कोई दिक्कत नहीं है. बट इश्यू इज कि ये होस्ट मशीन मेरा लैपटॉप होगा या डेस्कटॉप होगा या क्लाउड मशीन होगा, इसके बाहर किसी को अगर इसे एक्सेस करना है तो कैसे करेंगे, क्योंकि बाहर का मशीन तो इसके नेटवर्क में नहीं होगा ना. लेट मी ड्रॉ दिस. ओके, लेट्स से कि यहाँ पे एक नेटवर्क स्विच है या वाईफाई राउटर है, ओके, और आई एम हैविंग सम लैपटॉप और डेस्कटॉप हियर और मे बी अ मोबाइल फोन इन द सेम नेटवर्क. ओके, I will draw it using some different connection. There is a proper connection here and from here to here. Proper network connection is there. This is my network switch or network router. Let's say switch or a Wi-Fi router. Now, whatever the website is here, it is accessible inside the container. It will be accessible on the host machine, but by default, any external machine cannot access the container's port number 80. The reason is containers are in separate network, physical network is different. Okay. So how to resolve this issue? To resolve those issue, what we do is we'll choose some empty port on the host machine. Okay. We'll choose any empty port on the host machine. Let's say I will choose port number 4545. This is an empty port because this is not used by any service. You can use any random port, empty port. Okay, let's say I'll use 18080 or 28080. Okay, any random port of host machine, I will connect to the container's port number 80 like this. Logically, my host machine's port number 28080 will be connected to the container's port number 80. Okay, so from this particular laptop, if someone visited my host machine's IP address, Docker host machine's IP : port number 28080. If you put this request in the browser, this request will go to host machine's port number 28080. And if we map 28080 to the container's port number 80, obviously this request will be redirected, forwarded towards container. So container website, which is on port number 80, will be accessible outside this particular network as well. Here as well. Getting it? Few minutes back, we have tried doing the same thing. There is an image which holds Mario game. Okay, so that this was the container where on port number 8080, Mario web application is running. On port 8080/TCP. Okay, so what we are trying to do here is this container is connected to the host machine. Okay, so we are logically connecting them. I have chosen the port number 4545 of host machine. Okay, and I have mapped it to the container's port number 8080. So I got the Mario game access on the port number 4545 of the host machine from the container. Are you getting this? Please take screenshot of the screen. This will be helpful. Few minutes fact, we have performed this particular thing. Red container, you can see a red circle. That is one container we deployed for Mario game. Okay, that Mario games by some developer is already made as web application and it is running inside the container. And while running it, we are mapping containers port number 8080 to the host machine's port number. Any random port you can use, which is free. I have chosen 4545. And that's why from the external machines, you can access the web server or any application on particular port number of the container. If there is any doubt, any query, you can ask. Guys, please reply. Have you understood this concept? Basic networking knowledge is needed for this. Basic networking. Yes, please reply quickly, everyone. Okay, great. So can we try this then? The Mario game, I have shown you that how we have hosted it. Okay, you can see here, it is still running on this port number. I can still play this. Can you see that I'm able to play this game? Even the volume and everything is coming. I'm not sure the audio is passing you to not passing you. Okay. Likewise, I want to see that example, which is talking about web server. Okay. So have a look towards this particular diagram. I'm going to perform this operation now. I'm going to launch a Apache web server on a container. Okay, then you will see that how easy is there to launch a web server, how easy it is. Okay, within 2 minutes I can launch a web server. That web server launching is easy. Okay, because we have seen this, that in containers, developers have already created the container images. You just need to pull the image and you can use it. Okay. And if you want to customize it, take it, use it, update it, and you can have new versions of it. You getting it? So let's try to do this. So I have a quick look. I'll do one thing. Docker run. First check with Docker images. Sorry, Docker images. I don't have httpd or Apache image here. Only this Mario image and CentOS image is there. So what I'll do is Docker run hyphen ipnd interactive tty and detach. Then I'll use hyphen p stands for port number. I want to map host machine's empty port 28080 or 18080 : the container's port number 80, because Apache runs on port number 8080. Okay, that's why this mapping is there. First port is of host machine, second port after colon is of container. Just like this in the diagram. This 80 and this is 28080. Okay. Now I will use name my container. Let's say name is equals to my web one. Okay. And I will use the image httpd. Httpd is a default image given by Apache community. Okay. So this will first download the image, means pull the image, and then it will run the container. Okay, I'll do enter. Can you see that some status message is there? That is downloaded newer image for HTTPD:// and after that you can see one more message, that is a container ID. So if I check by Dr. PS command, you can see here two containers are running. One is with this Mario game and second one is HTTPD. See, name is my web. And you can observe in the ports section it is mentioned. Okay, from all host means any host, 0.0.0.0 means any machine on this earth which can connect to this particular host machine of mine can communicate on port number 28080. So that will redirect to containers port number 8080. Okay, now if I press Alt Enter, it will be back on the same previous way. Look, minimize terminal. Okay. So here what I can do is, can you see here port number 28080? I just click on that port number. Can you see the website? See here, some default pages there, it's saying it works. So less than 1 minute is required to create a web server using Docker containers or any kind of containers. Getting it? Now, you can see here, if I run the same command again, I'll just change the container name. Let's say it is my web 2. I'll do enter. It is throwing error because this 28080 port number is already bind. So I will choose any other port. Let's say a random port number, I'll choose 18080. Ah, my bad. I need to change the name as well. Server, my web 3. Okay. So if I check by Docker PS, you can see within few seconds only, I am able to launch one more web server, which is on port number 180 machine, redirecting to the containers port number 80. So there are two web servers running on two different containers right now with me. Okay. Open here. If I click on that, you'll see it works page again. See, this is from one server. This is from another server on port number 28080. This is on 18080. And on port number 4545, you can see my Mario game is also running. See, three web applications I'm running on containers, three different containers. Okay, I'll close this Mario one because sound is enable for that. So what I'll do is, someone can think like how those web servers are useful for me. So now guys, you people are IT people, right? So you many time write your website and web components, right? Let's say you are having your HTML code with you and you want to host that application. So if you want to host it, you simply need to do one thing only. That is, if you are a developer, you need to go with hosting a web server. Just call this HTTPD image and run here. Okay. Once you run this, what you have to do is copy the name of this container. Name is, what is name of the container? Is my web 3 and my web 1. Okay, so what I'll go with is, I'll go with Docker exec. Exec means execute hyphen it my web 3. Okay, I'll take batch access of it. So right now I am inside the container, you can see here. Okay, here if I do ls, you can see here htdocs name directory is there, which actually your document root. So I'll go into htdocs and you can see here is your index.html. Okay. If I do cat on index.html, you can see the content of it. It works. That is the HTML page which you are able to see here. Okay. So what I can do is I can change the contents. So if you are a HTML developer, you can write your code in this index.html page. I'm not a HTML developer, so what I'll do is I'll simply change the command, change the content by some random. So I'll do echo hello all in HTTP. Okay, and that I will redirect to index.html. These are basic commands. Okay, now if I read the index.html page, see the previous code is this one. Now the text, this one. Okay. Go to browser and refresh. Can you see what changed? So now 8080, it says port number 80 says hello all. Okay. Interesting, and please let me know in the chat box. I'll just come out of this container. Let's see the history. Please let me know in the chat box. What do you think? Any question, any difficulty, anything you need to ask? I can see one question here in chat box by Jagriti Chaudhary. What is that? So if a container is running on port 80, port number, then can we run another container through port number 80? Jagriti, I think you are not getting it. The concept is like this. See this diagram. Your container is as good as a virtualized platform, right? So every new container will have port number 80, right? Every new container, whatever I'm trying to draw here, every container will have its own port number 80, right? Like your laptop is having port number 80. My laptop is having port number 80, just like virtual machine is also having its own separate port number 80. Likewise, two containers are running with two different websites on their individual port number 80. Okay. And we are mapping it to the host machine, some random port number. Are you getting this? This is container, which is running on this particular machine. Okay. And it is also having port number 80. Okay, so we can map it to any other random port number. Let's say I will map it to this particular port number 80. I will map to host machine's port number 18080. Okay. This is the current scenario of my situation right now. Two web servers and one Mario application. So every container is having its own port number 80. So there is no confusion in running all the applications in different containers with same port number. Only host machine's port number you cannot repeat. You cannot map 28080 of host machine to more than one container. I hope Jagriti, you are getting this. Can we run Turbo C++? If Turbo C++ is available in Linux machines, obviously you can run it. Mr. Santosh, okay. Turbo C++, can you run on Linux machine? On Linux machine, mostly we use GCC compilers, right? but any application which run on Linux machine that obviously can run on the containers. Amit is trying to say something. Some things can be done in AWS EC2. So obviously I'm running containers on this particular Playbit Docker platform. I can also run it on virtual machine. I can also run it on my personal laptop. So likewise, I can run it on EC2 instance as well. Okay. And Amazon also provides container service as well. It is called it as an Amazon Container Service. Okay. So likewise, you can run n number of applications. Like you can run Tomcat server. Okay. You can run Jenkins server. You can run MySQL server. You can run MariaDB server. N number like web. I'm not sure you people heard about WordPress. You can run WordPress application as well on the container. Can we host website on PC with Docker even on double network connected? Kaustubh, I'm not getting your question. Can you please elaborate your question? Can we host a website on PC with Docker even on network connected? I'm not getting your question. We can. Right now I have shown you that how to host it on a Docker platform, right? So if you are running your Docker platform on your laptop, so obviously it can run. But if I'm not getting your question correctly, please elaborate your question. Okay. What does expose mean in Docker file code? Oh, good question, Gaurav. The point is we cannot discuss Docker file here. We don't have that much time. It need more time to discuss. But as you know, Docker file, I will let you know. If I'm using, take example, this Apache, or you can say HTTPD container image we have pulled ready, right? What if I want to create my own image? So for that, what I can use is I'll use CentOS or any Ubuntu container as a base container. And on top of that, I will install HTTPD and then I will write some configuration file and I will put index.html page. But this much is not enough, right? Containers port number 80 must be open for communication. Okay, so expose and port number will make that particular port number ready for communication. Is that okay, Gaurav? Kaustubh, I'm waiting for your question. What is it? Kaustubh, you got your answer or do you want any more explanation of it? Because I have it. I am not getting your question correctly. Sorry for that. If possible, you can elaborate the question. Okay. Kaustubh is saying Docker port forwarded one port to other. Another exposing to web, but every SIM carries does not allow port forwarding. So can it be done with Docker? Kaustubh, I think you're confused about the platform. The scene is your container is running on some host machine. You can expose any port of container and you can map it to any port number of your host machine. Okay, and if you are saying that this particular host machine, your network engineer is not, or the security engineer is not allowing port number 2880 of host machine to be get access outside, in that case other people cannot access this particular website, but it will be accessible, but port is not like clients are not allowed to visit the port. That will be the scene. One more thing, you cannot host any web service or any other application on the similar port on the host machine. Okay, because host machine is already redirecting those things to the containers. Okay, so it is suggested that you should not use this port number 280.180.80 or 4545 of host machine for any other purpose. Okay, Kaustam. Okay, good. I can see here, how can you run multiple containers using a single service? Which service you are saying, Rohit? Are you talking about this Apache service? Multiple containers I am running with Apache service. Is that your question? Rohit Kumar Kushwaha. Yes. It is very simple. No, I am giving the same answer again and again, guys. Your containers are as good as your virtual machines. It's very small in size, very customized, but as good as running virtual machines. So if imagine that I am having two virtual machines running on my laptop. So obviously I can host two web servers on both of the machines. Web servers I can configure on both of the machines, right? They will not disturb each other. Similarly, the same is the answer. Right now you are using Apache service of Apache service, but running on two different containers. Is that okay? Yes. See, I am running website, I am hosting one website on my laptop, and I am also hosting one website on your laptop. Your laptop and my laptop is in the same network. So are they going to disturb each other, Rohit? Answer to my question, Rohit. Are they going to disturb each other? No, right? Yes or no? Are they they are going to disturb? How come? I'm saying one web server is running on your laptop and my laptop is also holding one web server. So are they going to disturb each other? No, because those are different computers having their own port number 80s running and web servers are also up. Okay. So those are two different machines. No? So that's why they cannot disturb each other. The similar thing is happening here. We are running with two different containers. I'm not saying that I'm hosting two websites in one container. That is also possible. I'm not at all in the oppose of that. You can run multiple web services or multiple host services inside one container. That is also possible. But our duty is keep containers lightweight. So that's why one container, one web server we are using. Okay. So I think all the developers who wants to develop their application or normal websites or any random website, you can start using containers now onwards for designing your applications. Okay. Now let's see. I will show you one more thing. That is, what if I want to launch my own container image? I want to launch my own container image. Okay, so what we can do? So I'll give you one example of Python image where you can pull the image and you can run Python applications on it. Okay, and then I will let you know if I want to do it on a Ubuntu container and I want to make my own image like that, how we can do that. Okay, so observe it very carefully. So first I will stop all those running containers and everything. So you can see here this particular web3 name container is my web3 is running, right? Docker PS. Three processes are running. One is my web3. So I'll do docker stop my web3. You can see here one container got stopped. If one container got stopped, if you can see this, which is running on port number 18080, see the web server is not available. If you start the container again, you will get this website again up. Okay, then let me stop this particular first container, my web one. See here now only one container is running, that is Mario container. So if I go here and refresh the page, you can see here web server is gone. Okay, and only that application is running. Fine, even I can stop that as well. Docker stop game one. Cool. If I check Docker PS now, nothing is running. At any certain point I want to run it again, I'll simply copy the container ID or container name and I'll run a command docker start and that container name or container ID. So it will start it again. Okay. Now let's say I want to run my hello.py Python code, sample Python code I will run. This is not a programming workshop, so I will not write heavy code. I'll simply use a hello world print statement. Okay. So let's say I'll go with docker search Python. You can see here so many Python images are available. Among them, the official one, first one. See here, it's a Python is interpreted, interactive and object oriented language. Second is also official, but that is by Django framework. If you want a Django framework, by default configure, and on top of that, you want to start the development, you can simply pull this image and you can use it. Okay. So Django also runs on some random port number. Then you can also see here few like flask kind of things are, you can also run on port number 5000. So there are different network services. Two examples we have taken, that is of 8080 and port number 80, but 5000 port is there for Django framework. 3604 is there for database services. So there are different options. I'll choose this Python app image. Okay, name is itself Python. So what I can do is docker run -it or d as well. I'll do --name is equals to programming one. You can give any name. Okay, I'll use Python, this particular image, and enter. It says error responding Python daemon, responding the daemon, unauthorized authentication required. Okay, let me check the command again. Docker docker run --itd --name equals to programming one dash docker search Python. Okay, this is the name python docker run So it has started pulling the image. once the image will be ready, it will be able to run the container as well. Okay. So guys, what we can do is, if I check by Docker PS, you can see this container is running. That is programming to started with Python 3 command. Image name is Python and this is the container ID. Okay. So let's say I am a Python developer and I want to test some coding. So what I'll do is Docker run, sorry, Docker exec hyphen it programming to bash. You are inside the container now. If I check which OS it is, so let's see /etc. OS release is a file which talks about the operating system. It's a Debian operating system. You can see Debian Linux 10. Okay. And if I put on a command Python, see, I am right now on the Python interpreter, Python version 3.8.5. Okay. I'll do exit from the interpreter. And here I can write okay, VI editor is not there. So what I can do is I'll simply write this thing. Echo print I'll redirect this to hello.py. Okay. See, this is like to keep your container size small. They haven't installed VI editor, but you can use what we can say apt update command and apt install VI. So it will allow you to install VI editor inside it or whichever editor you want. With the help of that, you can start your programming. Okay. So if I do ls, you can see hello.py is there. If I run Python hello.py, see, it is able to print the program. It is running the program, right? You can see here. Okay. So likewise, you can start using the Python container as well. Now I want, just like this, I want to create my own image using CentOS. Imagine that I am not friendly with this Debian container. I want to create my own CentOS container with Python. So what I can do is, I want to create my image. Okay, we are looking into how to create our own images. So very simple. First, to keep all those clear and safely, I'll just copy this name and stop this container. Okay, Docker stop programming to okay. Now from this, what I can do is I will take CentOS image. This is a normal CentOS image, right? On this CentOS image, I will install Python thing, or if you want, I can go with the Ubuntu example as well. Which one you prefer? Ubuntu or CentOS? Okay, let's go with Ubuntu. Fine. So what I can do is Docker run --name equals to, let's say, my Ubuntu. You can take any name, okay? --IP image name, and I want to run bash, or maybe you can ignore this bash. Do enter. We have started pulling the Ubuntu image. You can see Docker images section. Ubuntu image is available. So what I'll do is, Ubuntu container is running. If you check Docker PS, see my Ubuntu name container is running. So inside this, I want to check Python is available or not. If not, I will install it. Okay. Docker --exec-it my Ubuntu bash. So we are inside the terminal now. Confirm that you are in Ubuntu container. See, it is saying name as Ubuntu. So fine, this is the Ubuntu OS. So what I'll do is Python. Says command not found. You can check Python, no version available. Okay. So what I can do here is I'll simply do apt --get update. So we are updating the repos inside it. Says done. Then I can go with okay, I'll just confirm it by typing capital S. And now you can see here Python version is getting installed. Okay. Here Python 2.7 is by default available now. If you want to install Python 3, you can do that as well. You just need to do one thing, get install Python 3. Now both versions will be available with me. One is Python 3.8 and one is Python 2.7. Okay, so you can run Python 3 interpreter. I'll do exit, as well as if you type only Python, it will give you Python version 2.7. Okay, so now my container is having these many things available. Okay, now I will also try to install something like VI editor. Okay. VIM is available, not VI. It's just like Notepad and Notepad plus plus. Okay. That is the difference. Similar difference is there with VI editor and VIM editor. So you can see here now I can use VI editor to create hello.py or any other file. Okay. Inside that, I will write my code. Whatever random code is there, maybe your IoT code is there, or maybe data science projects you do, or maybe image recognition, whatever code you write in Python, you can simply write it here. This is not that particular class, so I'll just only write printing hello from ID image of mine. Okay, this is my image, right? Okay, two print statements I'm writing here and saving this. You can see here hello.py is available on slash location. If I want to run it, I can run with Python hello.py. Okay, or using Python 3 if you want to run this, using Python 3. Fine. So these are my changes. I'll do exit. I just am out of the container right now, but my container is still running. You can stop the containers working as well, no doubt. Fine. So what my intention is, I want to create my own image from this. So now onwards, if I give this image to someone, they need not to install. They will have Ubuntu along with VIM editor as well as Python 2.7 and Python 3.8 installed into it. They need not to start from scratch. They will simply pull my image and they can use it. Okay. Or maybe I am going to use it in daily routine of mine for my Python practice. Okay. So what I can do, simple Docker commit. Container is running. From that running container, I am trying to create my image. So Docker commit. Docker commit. What I need to commit, this container ID or container name. Okay. My Ubuntu image. Sorry, my Ubuntu container. I need to commit by tag. Let's say Python and Ubuntu. That is what the name is. Okay. Enter. Sorry. It's giving me some error. Requires at least one and most two arguments. Okay. A hyphen T is not needed. Okay. So you can see this is the command Docker commit. Commit this particular container by this particular name. Okay, so if I check my Docker images, you can see here, I do have a previous image Ubuntu. I do have a previous Python image, but from this particular image, I have made some changes. I've updated it, some changes I made, and I have created this new image. You can observe the size as well. My Ubuntu image was only 73.9 MB. And my new image, which I have created, Python installed, VI editor installed. So that is of 200 MB. So that is what the installation and changes happened to your image. Okay. Now, what I can do is I can take this image and I can create a container from this. Okay. So what I will do is Docker. Docker run -it Python and Ubuntu. Okay, I'll do enter. And you see, I am right now inside the container. And if I do ls, you will be able to see the hello.py is already there. Why? Because in that container, the file was there. So that's why in the image also it is coming. Okay. And even I can use Python command to run that code, or I can write VI. I can use VI editor to edit this code, or can write new code as well. See here. Got it? I guess now you people are getting this idea that how people are creating images and how they are giving to you. Now the point is, I do have my office account as well. We do have Pawan name faculty. This is his laptop only. So all the username passwords are with me. So what I'll do is hub.docker.com. This is his login. Okay. So his login name is Pawan SW. So what I can do is I can push this image to registry now. How? I'll do this Docker login. I will put a name of his account and password. It says login successful. Now what I can do is Docker images. This is my image and I want to push it there. But the problem with this thing is if you are having such image like this, you cannot push it directly to registry. Because the image name must start with your login name. Okay. So what I'll do is I'll refer this image ID and I'll change the name of this particular image. How to do that? Docker tag. Okay. Docker tag this particular image by some name. That name must start with your login name slash. And then any name which you want to give to your image. Let's say Python VI. You're having Python 2.7. Okay. As well as 3.8. And VI editor. These many things we have added, right? So accordingly I have mentioned the name. So by looking into name only I can understand what is there inside this particular one. Okay, so what I'll do is Ubuntu as well I will add in the name itself, Ubuntu 20. So this is going to be my image name, fine. So I'll do enter. It says I'm missing something in the command. Docker tag source image tag target image. Okay. So Docker images. You can see here I got the same image ID twice appeared here with two different names. Because the same name, same image, I have labeled it as this. Now what I can do is I will simply do Docker push and this particular name of image. Okay. See, it is pushing this particular image to my Docker Hub account. Okay, now I go to my Docker Hub account and I just refresh this page. Can you see new image appeared here? It is saying that updated few seconds ago. If I click on this, you will get to know that in tags. See here. This is what a way how you can pull you this particular image on your machine. I'm putting the command in the chat box. You can try that. If anyone is having the thing in means the terminal in front of you, you can try this image, pulling this image and then run that image. You will get to see that Python along with Ubuntu, Ubuntu along with Python version 2.7, 3.8. As well as VI editor, all those things, including that hello world.py, everything is already in that image. Okay. Can Docker image have Windows? No, Aman, no. Till the date, we don't have any Docker, Windows container available. Yeah, you can run containers on Windows, but inside container, we cannot have Windows. Now there are some questions like, can we run your GUIs or other applications inside the container? The point is yes. Yes, you can. But for that, you have to be very sure that you know little bit Linux administration. The reason behind this is, if I give you a normal CentOS machine and or Ubuntu machine, and on top of that, I ask you to run Python IDE or any other IDE. So whatever installation steps are there, all those installation steps and everything you have to do on the image first. And then you have to build your own image. And on top of that, you can get the graphical accesses then. Okay. But always refer this thing. Don't go with graphical accesses. Go with web-based graphical accesses. That will keep your container in small size. Okay. So I'll share the history with you. And then I will stop the session from my end. Where is the terminal? Okay. This is the history. Some commands are having error. Yeah, I guess you observe the session very carefully, so you know what are those. Okay, I'll remove those commands which are having errors. Just a minute, guys. Okay, guys, everything got updated here. This, I guess, as a beginner, this much is enough. You should practice all those things, and later on, maybe in future, you can work for next things. Okay, so I can see one or two questions are there. Maybe I failed to answer this because in the chat it was difficult for answer those questions as well as perform all those things parallelly. because of time. So if I miss any question, I'm sure that you people can find it out. Else you can communicate me with me using LinkedIn profile and all. So that will be easy for you. Okay, you know my name, follow me on LinkedIn, follow our page as well. So that will help you. And in some cases, you can message me on LinkedIn. I will reply according to my time, but I'll surely reply. Okay. So that's it from my end. If any question, any queries are there, you can ask. Else, hand it over to the organizers.
Thank you so much, Ashutosh sir.
Thank you. It's you people are a great audience. Maybe in future we will continue the topic. Okay.
Sure, sir. Participants, if you want to ask any questions or queries, please type your queries in the chat box. Sir, there are two questions on the chat box. Can you please?
Okay. Guys, I have pasted my LinkedIn profile link here. You can follow me on that link. And if you are having any queries, you can ask there. Okay. So let me see the thing here. How to check which port is used for using Docker files from the Docker Hub. Which port to use for using Docker files from Docker Hub? Gaurav, you're missing something in the question. Is it like how to check which port is empty to be get used in Docker, or to be get used, or let's say how to expose the port and how to decide which port is empty? Is that your question? Okay. So it's like if any image is there, I'm pulling the image, how we can understand which port it is opening, right? That is your question. Okay. Very simple. I'll let you know. Okay. You just need to do one check. What is that check? Trial and error basis check. Okay. If as a beginner, that is the thing. If once you become expert in this, we know that, like, I'm using from many days. So obviously I know that, Tomcat runs on port number 8080. MariaDB or MySQL runs on 30. It means any random port number. Okay. It can run on random port number, but 3260 is the port number for that. So likewise, I know all the rest of the port numbers. But if you really don't know, what you can do is, let's say I want to run MySQL. So what I can do is Docker pull MySQL. Just wait, that image is getting, or let's say 5.6 image version 5.6. I'm pulling that particular version. Okay. Now what I will do is Docker images. This is my image. Where it is. Yes. MySQL. Okay. Take this image ID, copy it and do Docker inspect and the image ID. Okay. And in this inspect command, you just need to scroll up and see that is it showing that which port to be get used. See here, expose ports getting this? You need to inspect the image. Inspect means read the information about the image. Getting it? I guess this answers your question. Inspect, Docker inspect and image ID. Then I can see here one more question. Okay. How can we share this not globally but privately? Kaustubh, it is very simple. The Docker Hub I'm using, that is the public registry. That's why it will be accessible to everyone. Okay. If I use my private registry, maybe my internal, my college is having its own registry server, or my organization is having my own registry server. So there, public and private kind of image you can create. If it is a private one, obviously people need to give the username and password to access it. Okay, Kaustubh. How do I run multiple copies of Compose file on the same host? I don't think this is the right platform to answer this question because we haven't discussed Docker Compose. Okay. I guess Rohit, you can ping me. We can discuss it later, but this is not the right platform. Other people will get confused about it because we haven't completed the Docker. How we can discuss the Docker Compose, right? Okay. I guess all questions are got answered. And it's already 5. Okay. So over to you, organizers.
Thank you,
okay,
sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, so participants, please fill the form shared to you by sir on the chat box. And with this note, this 2-day HTTP on Docker containers comes to an end. I hope you all got a lot to learn. I, Tanishk Sachdeva, on behalf of Department of Information Technology, Oriental Institute of Science and Technology, would like to extend a hearty thanks to the speaker, Mr. Ashutosh Bhakre, sir, for sparing his precious time and sharing his knowledge with us and making us literate with Docker technology. Thank you, sir. I would like to thank Professor Sunil Kumar, sir, Vice Chancellor, RGPV, and Professor S.C. Chaube, sir, TechWeb 3 Coordinator, RGPV, who gave us opportunity to organize this HTTP program. I would also like to thank Chairman, Oriental Group of Institutes, Shri Praveen Thakral, sir, CEO, Oriental Group of Institutes, Shri R.K. Sahani, sir, and Director, Oriental Institute of Science and Technology, Dr. K.G. Sudhakar, sir, for their motivation and continuous support. I would also like to thank Professor Prateek Bhuske, sir, Coordinator and Head of Department, IT, and Mr. Kuldeep Mishra, sir, Coordinator and Training Head, for their constant support and helping us organize this event successfully. Thank you to all the participants for your support and showing enthusiasm in attending the HTTP. Thank you, everyone. Now, an important announcement regarding the distribution of certificates. Participants will receive the e-certificates within 4 to 5 days on your mail.
This is a report of the two-day session. We have discussed about the basics of Docker and containers, relating containers to real-life examples, how the containers are useful for developers as well as everyone. Administrator was discussed in the session, containerization, introduction to containers, history of containers, namespace and C groups, containers versus virtual machines, types of containers, Docker architecture, container life cycle, Docker CE versus Docker EE. Thank you. Thank you, all the participants.